Video games are practically miracles. We're always in awe of them here at GameRanks, you know, how they're made and what goes into them. And we've tackled this specific topic before in the past, but there are always more examples, you know, some tricks and hidden game systems that developers implement to essentially make the game work or convince you, the player, of something in order for the game to just feel right. Now, just a disclaimer, we are laymen. We are not game developers, we're not experts, but we're gonna try to explain these in the most simplest pedestrian ways we can. We've got 10 examples, so let's get started off with number 10 and talk about the coyote time concept. This is essentially game developer slang or jargon for how many frames you have after you pass a ledge or a cliff where you can still technically press and execute a jump. You ever feel like in a game you get away with a little more than you should? You step off that ledge a little too far, but you can still jump just in the nick of time to get that satisfying, perfect landing? That is, in a way, intentional and by design. Every game with a jump mechanic implements this very differently, but essentially, coyote time as a concept is based off of Wile E. Coyote. Remember the old cartoons where he'd be chasing the Roadrunner and then he would run off a cliff, float in midair, and realize that he was about to fall? That's essentially what this means here. You get it now, it's almost like you get a little bit of an extra split second in the air in order to jump. It's obviously way smaller than any window of time Wile E. Coyote got to have, but still, it's a thing, but it's different for every game. It explains why every video game platformer feels different, and every single game you play, you have to get used to how you specifically time your jumps, when you press that jump button, how close to the ledge you do it. A lot of that feel is thanks to this coyote time idea. Also, as just a fan of old classic cartoons, I love that a lot of people refer to it as this. Now next at number 9, here's another interesting one that a lot of the times refers specifically to first-person shooters. The reality is, nobody likes dying. Video games want you to essentially see how you die. The way a lot of developers look at it, and the way a lot of players look at it, if they just die suddenly, randomly, and they can't tell or see or have any indication of why, they'll get frustrated. So in certain games, developers actually kind of make this a case. Specifically in games like Call of Duty, the enemies almost always miss when you're looking away from the action. Obviously, you're still going to take some damage, and especially on the higher difficulties, but the chances of direct hit are often reduced, and it's not just Call of Duty, it's a lot of games. And then in other examples, like Bioshock, the Big Daddy, like super fast run speed when he charges fast towards you, apparently that's actually lessened a little bit and turned down a little bit for when you're facing away from him. So you have a little bit of an extra window to get away. Usually, it's not enough to make a game easy or anything like that, because players would quickly figure it out and exploit it, but it's just enough to still be satisfying and always know where your hits or where your death is coming from. Next at number 8, we already mentioned this in the intro, but developing games isn't easy. It takes a lot of work, and there are countless problems and finite time to solve all those problems. Sometimes a bug or a crash is going to require a clever solution, or really, a workaround. It's hard to find examples, but in some circles of the internet, people report the developers of Godfather, the game, figured out a funny way to fix a certain crash, when the crash event is detected in-game, an invisible sniper would one-hit kill the player. So apparently, if this is true, it was like the developers' cheap way of avoiding the game crashing and just making it seem like you died randomly somehow. An unexpected death in a game is still better than a crash anyway, right? Next, over at number 7, we did mention the developers of the Godfather game, Visceral Games, the legendary studio which doesn't exist anymore. Well, they did also make that crazy hell-themed action game Dante's Inferno. Remember that one from EA? According to a former developer who posted on Resetera forums, due to a bug that wasn't discovered until late in the game's development, the health upgrades that you acquire throughout the game don't even actually end up doing anything. They actually make your health meter longer, but it doesn't actually give you any more HP. It's just a visual thing alone. If you want to read the full quote, we're gonna link all of our sources in the description below. But yes, that just makes me wonder, what games don't we know about? What games out there are we completely lied to about our health bar? You know, the average player, we only really know what we can experience with our hands and our eyes in the game. What aren't they telling us? That's what I'm saying. I'm like putting on my tinfoil hat here. But next, over at number 6, of course, one of the best things ever are all those magical tricks that developers use to hide loading screens. Yes, more and more games have pushed to completely get rid of loading screens. Now, that was, in the past, more of a hardware limitation. Thankfully, Now, in 2021, we have fancy new PCs with SSDs, we have next generation consoles, where things can load lickety-split, and loading screens are starting to be a way of the past. But for the previous console generations, if an ambitious development studio wanted to hide those loading screens, they had to put in some crazy work, not only on the technical number crunching side, but also on just the sleight of hand trickery side. There are so many examples out there, like the original Mass Effect. Any early review for that game, or just any player, would pan it for the absolutely ungodly long amount of time you'd spend in an elevator waiting for it to go up and open. You spent a lot of time in elevators in the original Mass Effect, and it was absolutely ridiculous and boring, and it was because that was the game hiding the fact that it was loading in new stuff. You'd still be in the elevator, you could move the camera around, you'd feel like you were in control and existing in that game world, but behind the scenes, the game was really loading everything in. Think of Uncharted games or even like Dark Souls games where the player takes a long time to push open a big door. That's because that next area is being loaded in, dude. The best example though, something more recent that I am completely sick of, is the old player slowly crawls through a crack in the wall. At first, it seemed like a very cool novel thing to watch your character shimmy through a crack in a wall and the camera would follow you through. But as they got more and more repetitive, a lot of players picked up on the fact that some games, not all, were using this to hide loading. You know, like how many times can a player in a third-person action adventure game crawl through a crack in the wall? It's ridiculous. But hey, you gotta do what you gotta do, right? Next up at number five, a really clever trick that some players might just not pick up on. If it's done right and if it feels natural, it's like colored or lighted areas that serve as focal points that essentially guide you forward in a game. Believe it or not, in certain types of games, if you were left completely up to your own devices, you wouldn't necessarily know where to go, or it would just kind of slowly hurt the flow of the game. Specifically, a lot of the time, action adventure games, they want to keep you moving, they want the scene to be well paced. You will be guided kind of subconsciously towards the next thing. Maybe it's just a doorway with a little light bulb flickering above it. Maybe in a lot of ways, we've talked about this in previous videos, an entire level or a room is designed specifically to guide you the right way in a natural flow. Or, of course, maybe it's a splash of color or some sort of brighter designator showing where you need to go or what you need to grab. Obviously, one of the most easy examples are action adventure jumping climbing games where the ledges that you can grab have very specific scratched up markings on it, or maybe bird poop on a ledge, or just a little bit of a different texture. Not every game is subtle about this. Some games, it looks ridiculous, and it just looks like you're climbing through like a carnival. But hey, some developers decide to go more obvious, some go more subtle. Really, when games figure out that perfect in-between that guides your brain, but without beating you over the head with it, that's the sweet spot. Next, over at number four, the concept that your last few shots do more damage. Now, in another video where we talked about this stuff, we mentioned your last bit of health lasting longer, but this time we're talking about your actual ammunition. To really make your last shots count, games will increase the power of your weaponry's last shot in certain games when developers are feeling that it will help. In the Gears of War series, the last bullets in your magazine always end up doing a little bit more damage than the first. In System Shock as well, your final bullet does double damage every single time. But that's extremely helpful in a survival horror game where ammo is just extremely limited anyway, so it's kind of like a godsend. Sometimes the first shot is more useful too, and I'm not talking about in the Gears of War active reload bonus way, more of like a behind the scenes type of way. In Half-Life 2, the shotgun always has a perfectly accurate pellet on the first shot. That way, if you're aiming for something specific, the first shot will always land. Complete randomization isn't always fun, and it seems like that's what Valve decided with that gun. Now down to number three, here's a trick that's gone completely by the wayside thanks to, you know, newer graphics technology, ray tracing, good lighting, stuff like that. Before, we could use graphics cards to literally generate a mirror image of a scene in a game. Developers had to use really clever tricks to make a mirror in a game feel convincing. Build engine games like Duke Nukem 3D and Blood had an ingenious little trick to make mirrors. They essentially would just copy and invert the room. So in a lot of ways, that mirror that you were looking at is actually just a window into a complete other room that you just can't access. The old inverted mirror trick gets them every time. Really, video game mirrors are still not perfect. How many console games have you played where you walk up to a mirror and it's like barely a mirror or not a mirror at all? Or if it is, it's just really crappy. That has been something that has seemed like it has taken forever to crack, and we're happy that the technology has evolved, but props to the developers back in the day who figured out scrappy ways to make mirrors actually feel like mirrors. Now down to number two. Oh man, I don't know if I like this one. This one is devious. This is essentially early multiplayer help tricks to get you hooked. So for example, the developers of Gears of War apparently used a trick to help beginners have more fun in online multiplayer. The developers actually discovered that apparently 90% of players would quit forever if they lost their first multiplayer match. Now, in Gears of War 2 and 3, first-time players in multiplayer get a bunch of buffs to ease them into the match, literally giving them an unfair advantage without even really realizing it. If you've ever felt like you've had beginner's luck in a video game, it might be because the developers wanted it that way. We've noticed this more and more with mobile games. Games like Call of Duty Mobile start you out in matches with bots, even when it doesn't seem like it's a tutorial. So you kind of kick some ass, you feel great, and you're gonna continue to play the game once you start picking up the ropes. It is definitely a little bit manipulative, and I think it might be a little questionable, or at the very least, maybe a topic for another video that we'll make in the future. Let us know what you think. But down to number one, it's the idea, dude, that speed can be faked. Straight up, video games are about spectacle, the glitz, the glam. You wanna feel excitement. The developers want you to feel excitement when you're blasting enemies or you're cruising through something at high speeds. So stuff like in Need for Speed, your boost actually doesn't increase your speed that much, but the change in FOV and the effects that are displayed on screen are what really make you feel like you're going way faster, even if physically in the game, you're not as much as you think. There's another big example of this in Mass Effect. Your sprint doesn't actually make you move any faster in combat. Seriously, the sprint just helps you move a little bit faster outside of combat, but when the fights start, the sprinting does nothing at all. It only exists to make you feel like you're running and the camera changes cool, that's it. But racing games are where it's really the most effective. Yes, in a lot of racing games, when you hit the turbo boost, you are going faster, but a game has a good sense of speed, not by how fast your car is technically moving in a space on that screen. No, it's how the game gives you visual indicators, how well it shows and gives you that sense of speed through visual cues. Every game is different, every game has different tricks, and we're always just in awe and we marvel at these little things that just trick our lizard brains and make us have more fun. But there are more examples out there, so if you've ever heard any legends in game development, we want to hear from you in the comments. Anything you picked up on in one of your favorite games, some trick to make the game feel more satisfying or just more enjoyable or more convincing, anything, let us know. And if you enjoyed this video and maybe if you learned something, clicking the like button is the best way you can help us out. We would genuinely appreciate that. But if you're new, consider subscribing, hitting that notification bell, because we put out videos every single day. As always though, thanks for watching, and we'll see you guys next time.